best way to get the police out. Officially, she's a privacy officer at a large vocational education school. As you can imagine, there's a lot of privacy problems there. She will dig in depth. That being said, she's also, you can say, part of the hacker scene, as she visits the headquarters too quite often. And she's been a good friend to Arjen Kamphuis. The book, which is being presented here at Hacker Hotel, she actually compiled this book about how much time I can give a friend by doing that. That being said, we're not going to talk about privacy, education.
Yes, I am. Welcome. Thank you for attending my talk. It's the first time I'm talking in English, so I hope I'm not lost for words. Privacy in tech is a must. You have to see to it because it's a legal requirement. And there is security without privacy. There is never privacy without security. Privacy, IT professionals lay the foundation for good privacy compliance in an organization. And usually security professionals think about information security, but that's different from data protection. In our Dutch edition of the GDPR, the General Data Protection Regulation, the word privacy is only mentioned once in a small footnote. It's all about data protection. And the changes in this environment go fast, so you're usually galloping on your horse next to the train in the hope you can hold on to your hat. It's difficult to keep up, so it's constant awareness of what you have to do as IT professional, make the right impact assessments when changes are there and how you can cope with them. So I'm going to talk just a little bit about myself. There's a slide at the end which tells you where you can download my presentation, and there's notes in them as well, so you can read more. I'll go about the GDPR, just the basics, because I want to mainly talk about privacy in tech, to get that connection. And that will mainly be about privacy by design. And I'll give examples, some very simple, how you can achieve privacy by design. And some best practices from vocational education and what you can do to help. So I'm a privacy officer, as said, at a large vocational education institute, over 18,000 students and 2,000 staff. So it's a complex institution with over 200 applications, for example. So I wrote three books, and I translated the book of Arjen Kamphuis that he wrote with Silke Carlo, Information Security for Investigative Journalists. And you can find that at Bescherm je Gegevens, also an English edition, .nl. And I was part of Team Arjen Kamphuis, and you can buy the book, and I'll show it later to you if you missed it at the entrance where someone of the audience just laid on the table. I hope it's better this way. So, and if I talk about myself, I also have to tell you I love Creative Commons licenses and Ducati motorbikes. So if you talk about what does a privacy officer do, a lot of people, especially IT professionals, have no clue. There are four main focus areas. It's a judicial, you do something with the regulations for the company, policies, training, advice, also of the staff. They can ask me questions whenever they like, and I make frequently asked questions databases so they can look up answers for themselves. There's something with technique, and that's where we're heading today. There are technical measures you can make, can do, and organizational measures you can take for data protection, and I'll give you some examples. And some other stuff, data breach team. If there's a data breach, I'll be the one to address what happens and how can we prevent it from happening in the future, by which measures. So it's a lot of different stuff like this, very complex, and I wasn't even talking about all the, how do you call it, what happens in an organization with people and what they want, because you have to get them in line together. But if you're into privacy, like I am, then you can indulge yourself. Okay, so privacy in technology, I already said it is a must. And if you can answer who can do what and why is that, you're on the right track. And that's not always that easy. So it's information security goes about confidentiality, the CIA, integrity, and availability. And if you have seen, read something about the ransomware attack at Maastricht University, you know they all three have been breached. You cannot trust your data anymore. You must assume the data is exposed and people can read it. Something very important, but what I'm not going into it, authentication, authorization. Authorization is, of course, who can do what and why is that? Monitoring, logging, very important in applications. So that must be addressed when you develop, when you design. You see, this is the picture you can look up on Wikipedia. So what's it about? Personal data, what is personal data or privacy identifiable, personal identifiable information? Well, we can discuss about IP addresses, whether it's direct information leading to a person or not. But usually these information is indirectly leading to a person. I said something about the difference between data protection and information security. And here you can see this is Hugo Leising of the National Cyber Security Center made this, and it's making very clear the differences between the two. And one of the main differences is what green is the compliance is obligated by law. There, in data protection, you can make choices, you check and balance, and then you choose. And this is also very different. The transparency is important for data protection. And as where information security, how you do that is, of course, confidential in an organization. You don't want to say how you protect your information. So if you have the GDPR, data protection regulation, there's four main focus areas. And I always translate it like this. Management, of course, on top, because they decide if they put money into it, which they should, of course. And the foundation is IT. This is where it's done, because we put all this personal data in applications. So the basics, it's a bit boring, so I'll just go about it fast, but you have to know a bit of context to realize how you can go about it in developing. Before you put personal data in applications, you must make sure you may process data. There must be a legal reason for it. So there's six legal grounds. In education, we usually use there's a contract, so you need information. You could use a legitimate interest and consent. A lot of people think consent is the reason you may collect data, but it's really impractical because someone can just refuse consent or withdraw consent. So usually it's not the way you want to go. You want to make sure you can process what you want to process without asking consent. Then there's the rights of data subjects. You as an individual may ask for a deletion of data. Sometimes an organization can, sometimes they can't, because they have a legal requirement of storing data for a couple of years. That you have to be able to show what's in your application, what you processed, what you collected. And preferably, you see to it in the application that can be automated. That you do with privacy by design. And I'll go into that. There are some special categories of information, sensitive information. So there's extra requirements before you can process that data, and you also have to make sure there's extra security for that. Funny thing is, as soon as data is anonymous, the GDPR is not applicable. So that's something important. You can do more with information if it's anonymous. And what is anonymity? I'll go into that. So, there are collection limitations you can collect, but you can't use it for other purposes. and you don't collect what you don't need, and you have to go about retention, deletion, the information lifecycle management, and you must stop collecting and delete information when required. So why do we do this? Yes, you may. So why do we do all this? Because we want to prevent a data breach from happening. I'm not sure if you know this funny gate at Schiphol Hotel, but it's quite useless because you can't just go around it. So I said something about the rights of data subjects, you as an individual. These are the rights you have, and portability, think of, for example, exporting your photos from Instagram to a new photo service, something like that. You can object, you can ask for rectification, restriction, etc. And it is perfect if you expect a lot of persons who want to effectuate their rights, that you can just push one button and you can fulfill their questions. So privacy by design is required by law in the GDPR. This, you have to do this. In education, we are working mostly on privacy by redesign at the moment because we have applications that are older and we have not yet the option to, you can't just start tomorrow with a new application. So we try to, what we have, to improve that. But privacy by design is in the design where you keep, how do I put it? Well, in the basics, you integrate data protection. And in that is privacy by default. So cookies are opt-in and not opt-out, for example. So privacy settings by default. So if you talk about privacy by design, I'll just click one through. This is a framework of the Dutch privacy company. Privacy company gave advice to our government about the data impact assessment for Office 365. And they have eight topics in their framework. And you see anonymization is the first step. And if you can't do that, you're really collecting, then there's the next steps you have to reckon with. For example, data minimization. Do you ask for the birth date or maybe just the birth year, for example? There's data minimization, pseudonymization, encryption, access management, not just for the staff who can enter an application to do stuff, but also for the data subject itself. There must be secure processing, retention, deletion, and the rights facilitated. Well, I talked about that already. I added one, proper management. You need to update and patch, of course, as well. Okay. If you talk about privacy by design, there are privacy enhancing technologies. I've mentioned these, it's just from Wikipedia. And in education, we have the soft. We trust a third party, we have to, so we address topics like this. This is just one application who talks with organizations, other applications, to give you a sense of how complicated it may be. And this is the student information system. And you talk with the government and all other sorts of organizations and internal departments. So this is an example of data minimization. We used to be able to ask for a student has to tell why he's not at school, why he's absent. But as soon as someone's ill, you can't ask for the reason why. What do you have? You're not allowed to ask that. So recently, the field has been made impossible to fill. So when somebody's ill, he's ill. Okay, you're absent, you're ill. You don't have to say, I have migraine or I'm going to a doctor for example, an abortion. Students are really putting everything in that field and to honesty. When they go to the doctor or when they're ill, they can't fill it out anymore. And the fun part is, when you don't collect that sensitive data, you don't have to provide for multi-factor authentication. So less hassle, less costs. Another one, be smart if you develop. This is just the design. If you click a few millimeters in the old situation, an email will go through all students of an entire class instead of just the one you want to mail. in the new design, it's just apart from each other, so you do misclick so easily. So it can be in very tiny things. I said something about authorization. I'll skip this slide because otherwise I won't be ready in time. But this is important also, authorization, and the realization that, for example, reading is something else as exporting. And in a lot of applications, if you open a PDF, you can also download it, print it. And that's exporting, and it's something different. It's not always possible to do that in the development to make sure it can be done. So there is, you need also organizational measures, agreements about what you do with the data. Okay, I asked on Twitter before I did this talk, what do you want me to address in this talk? And somebody asked, what set of combination of data makes personal identifiable information? Personal identifiable information. It's interesting because by research of Ms. Sweeney, 87% of the Americans can be found by only three identifiers. So there's strong identifiers that are also quite common. Gender, the date of birth, and the postcode, the postal zip code. That's, I'm also doing this talk in Dutch, so I may have made a mistake there. Okay, the spoiler is traceability is almost unavoidable. But when is it? We'll look into that. And a first name, of course, is not personal identifiable information unless you're Madonna or Maradona, for example. And look good, it's just it's two fingers, not just the one. Here you see policies, regulations, and you increase privacy by architecture. And there's another slide, you can look into it if you're interested later on. Because it's a little bit too much information for this one, but it's a really good help to check how privacy-friendly your application is. Okay, when is anonymous anonymous? Anonymous is irreversible. There is no way you can identify a person afterwards. And when pseudonymous, you can, if you have the right parameters, you can just retrace whose information it is. Important is also aggregation. You put stuff in groups. That's the solution to anonymity. It's a difficult word. aggregation, merge data into groups. And I'll give you an example of that. It looks a bit complicated, but I will talk you through it. The red lines keep identifiers. Because the school, this goes about a test with very private information. It's a very good test. The government, the Ministry of Education, sees to it so that students can take the test without the school having to pay for it, so they think it's important. And at our school, it was in our curriculum, so no certificate, no graduation if you did not take this test, but we didn't do it properly. If you ask a student, do you have sex, how many alcohol do you drink? When do you drink more than 6 glasses of alcohol? Do you use mushrooms or other drugs? It's very private. And we forced the students to answer, and they couldn't skip questions, and there's a problem in that. So when the organization that made the test went to another supplier, we said, hey, as educational institute, you have to design it differently because we can't keep doing this. So there's also an obligation for the IT security professionals. You must ensure privacy in the system because otherwise you lose customers. Because we wouldn't have been able to go through with the testing in the following years because we were not compliant with the law. So we fixed that as institute in conversation with the supplier. In the beginning, we only know if somebody has started the test, if it's on the way or when it's done. The results are being used for healthy education. It's a special program in schools that you have to see to, also by regulation, by law. So at the moment, they make some of the modules. Ethical question has also been addressed, so people can, even if it's anonymous, the test, they can skip answers if they don't feel if they want to answer, so the data is also better, but you can, if a student must answer a question, how many alcohol drinks do you consume, they might fill out 60 or 100. So data validation is maybe also something to address. So, but it's important, I underlined it, ditch the identifiers, and that is something we have to check as an institute. Is that really being done? So this information is anonymous. The supplier cannot know if he ditches the identifiers, who answered what question. The data is aggregated for the school, so they also cannot identify who filled it out. So if they want to know from a special course how many of what answer a woman gives on a special question, there need to be 30 answers, and otherwise there won't be a result. So they never can take it back to the user in the class. And this is one of the best practices. So we're now complying with law, and other schools that didn't take the test anymore are now also back as a customer. Another example, the pedagogical dossier. There is a part that can be transferred from one to another in staff, but there's also a part that can't. And the student has to give consent before it can be transferred to another mentor. That's really sensitive data, and for this system you need multi-factor authentication. So there's some other techniques for privacy enhancing technology you can use to anonymize the data. I'm not going into that too far because where am I in time? 50 minutes left, okay. There's also something about data masking, encryption, and when do you do what, to be exact. So there's also, when you design websites, there's some bad ethics, like the Washington Post here, who thinks that privacy is related to the EU somehow, I don't know. Or bad programming and bad ethics, because unless you think this is transparent, usually people will just hit the green button and all cookies will be opt-in. Okay, and this is our website of Delgium, and we are doing it quite nicely, unless there's always the question, do you really need the cookies? But I'd say marketing and statistics, why not just, if we're doing it right, you can just say better surfing experience, because there's a page where they can set cookies. Okay. Directly applicable, what can you do? Think and act. Be familiar with the policy of your company. Anonymize if you can, and if you can't, just collect as little as necessary. Encrypt your servers, your network, your database, whatever suits your needs. You have to balance out what's best for you. It can mean that you have to have better high-performance servers, which cost more. Just don't hold back in server security. I hear too often that somebody knows, oh, we need to patch it. We're not going to tell the manager because we have not enough staff to do it. So you will be vulnerable. Just speak out. The manager can decide. Maybe he'll just hire persons to do that. And if there's sensitive data, what goes into an application, like the one I just showed you with the questionnaire, ask, is this legal what we're going to do? And there's also something like decision makers, educate them, because we have our accountant thinks that complicated passwords are obligatory. And we also, every year we get a minus for it, but we say no, it's not necessary to make it complicated, because it's all zeros and ones. It needs to be strong, it needs to be lengthy. So, not sure if you have sat in the room, but...
Yeah.
Yeah, you could try it, yeah. So, and cookies need to be opt-in. It's also by the Judicial Court of Europe that made an arrest about and took a decision about it. So, and are they necessary in the first place? What will also help, speak up. If you speak up, you might be able to prevent a reputation going down the drain. I like this. Are you a business? Read it here. Why, we don't care at all. Oh, you don't want them to say that about your company. So, at the introduction, it was already mentioned the book of Arjen Kamphuis in the sector of education. Open standards are becoming slowly but steadily more important. Universities have said lately in Volkskrant newspaper in the Netherlands, we need to be more independent of American software. And he wrote a lot of good stuff about that and why it's so important to have open source and open standards. So I say, buy that book and read out for yourself. At Grand Knows Why, you can also get it here in front of the hotel. If you forgot who it was, that's him. Credit where credit's due. I am for ambition, that's why I'm here in the first place. Brenno gave me some suggestions. Jilles here in front of me helped me with input, feedback, and some other guys who also helped me explain stuff and make my presentation better. You can download it at www.arteos.nl. Okay, what if the, I don't know if there are questions.
Could everybody hear the question? Okay.
Yeah, you're asking for this one. I'll just switch back.
Yep.
Here, the white the vault, how to transfer it. This is done automatically, and that one must be done manually.
How is that implemented, that manual part? Like students coming to a computer and pressing yes? Or
No. They will go check, and he really has. We have not much to sign. This is a consent form. And this is really, because it's sensitive information, you really need to sign a paper.
Procedural.
That's procedural, yeah. When it's there, it's also stored in the vault, and it can be transferred to the next. So the person who has to do the manual transfer needs to have that paper.
Compliments. Awesome talk, and thank you for deobfuscating GDPR and AVG.
Thank you. Okay, thank you for your...